Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. We are about to begin our next session titled Higher Learning or the Wholesaling of Degrees. Speakers for this session are Wasif Rizvi, Ishrat Hussain, Talib Sayyid Karim, Shehnaz Wazir Ali. The session will be moderated by Mehtab Karim. Please switch off your mobile phones or put them on silence mode. There will be a question and answer session at the end of the discussion. We would appreciate if complete silence is observed while the session is in progress. Dr. Mehtab Karim is professor in the School of Public Policy at George Mason University, Virginia, and is coordinating a university partnership program for building the research capacity of junior faculty members at the University of Karachi. He has been professor and head of population and reproductive health program at the Aga Khan University and held academic appointments at St. John Hopkins University, Princeton, the London School of Economics, UK.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thanks, KLF, for giving us an opportunity to talk a little bit about education, especially higher education. I would say the amenities of higher education in Karachi, starting with Dr. Ishrat Hussain, and then of course Mr. Shehnaz Wazir Ali, Wasif Ali, and Talib Karim. Yes, there is a relationship, but I won't be biased in favor of IOBM. Higher education is something which everybody is talking about all over the world. As a matter of fact, a couple of years ago, economists came up with a major story on higher education, and they say everybody is going to universities. So it has become a trend that lot and lot of people are seeking higher education all around the world. Like in many other areas, unfortunately, Pakistan is far, far behind. If you look at the UNESCO statistics, only 5% of those who are between 17 to 23 years of age, that's college-going population, only 5% of them are attending universities and colleges in Pakistan, as compared to 10% in Bangladesh, 15% in India, 33% in Egypt, and 38% in Turkey, and of course 73% in South Korea. So we are far, far behind other developing countries. And so I would say that higher education is indeed in crisis. And at the top of it, if you look at the title of the session, is Wholesaling the Degrees. If you pick up any Sunday newspaper, and you would see that the universities, which about perhaps half of us have not even heard of, they are providing degrees from bachelor's to master's to MPhil to PhD. And are they doing the right job? That's one thing which I would be asking our illustrious panelists here. But let me start with Dr. Ishrat Hussain. He doesn't need an introduction. Fortunately, I have had fortunate to be knowing him for the last 40 some years. He has been in the World Bank, State Bank Governor, he has been on many committees of the national important committees, and of course he has turned around IBA during the last 8 years of his stay there. So let me ask Raksa about your view about what's happening, what is the crisis? Are we facing any crisis in the education sector, higher education sector in Pakistan?
I think this term crisis is very frequently misused in our discourse. And let me start with this question of access to higher education. McKinsey just did a report on Indian professional education. And despite the fact that we all are such great admirers of Indian educational system, their conclusion was that 10% of the graduates who come out of the top professional institutions, engineering universities, science institutions, IIMs, IITs are world-class. They can be employed by any company, any multinational organization, any multilateral bank without any hesitation. 40% are mediocres who can be employed in some position or the other in domestic economy, in industry. And 50% are totally unemployable. They don't have any skills or anything which makes them attractive to the potential employer. So everywhere in the world, the numbers and the quantities are quite high, but you have to investigate as to what lies behind those numbers. Pakistan, 10 years ago, had only Aga Khan University, LUMS, and IBA, which could be characterized as the top universities. Today, I can name at least 20 universities, including the universities in the public sector, like the UET Lahore, UET Peshawar, Henry University here in Karachi, even Mehran University, because I studied at Sindh University and we should to look down upon Mehran University, Sakhar IBA, Bitumus in Quetta, Institute of Management Sciences in Peshawar, NUST in Islamabad, GIK Institute in Topi. These Lahore School of Economics, Foreman College University, these are the institutions which have expanded and are providing high quality. Of course, 40% or 50% our universities are still producing mediocres. And 50%, I suspect, I have no information about the distribution in Pakistan, but taking the McKinsey report as the benchmark and applying that to Pakistan, we will have 50% people who are not employable. And the reason is that we are producing those degrees for which there is no demand in the economy. I went to Allama Iqbal Open University. They produce 40 PhDs every year in Islamic studies, 30 PhDs in Urdu. Now you tell me how many of them can find jobs in any part of the system with degrees in Islamic studies, Urdu, and subjects like this, while we have huge shortages of science and technology education. So it is not the numbers, it is the composition of education. And I'm quite happy that now we have Habib University in Karachi, which has established a state-of-the-art, internationally competitive school, both in social sciences and engineering. So we have to multiply the number of first-rate institutions and the second-rate institutions in this country in order to be relevant for the economic needs of this country. We have a younger population. They should not be going only up to the matric without any jobs, but they should be going to technical and vocational training institutions. You have worked in Aga Khan University. Every nursing student who graduates is offered job abroad. We should have more nursing schools, but we don't allow our own daughters and sisters to become nurses because there is a social taboo, because that is not accepted. But there is a huge demand for plumbers, electricians, masons, all kind of welders, HVAC operators, all over the world. So instead of giving them the degrees which are not relevant, if you give them skills, Amantak produces these graduates, they are absorbed right away in the Middle East. They are 250 to 300, they are absorbed. Hunar Foundation has started with the same thing. So we have to look at the linkage between the demands of the economy and what our university system and higher education is producing.
Well, thank you very much. I think it's a very good analysis of where we stand. That's a one question. I think it's a follow-up question, and I think if any other person would like to respond to that, that would be a welcome idea. My concern, I've been teaching at one of the universities in US for the last 8 years, and I have been going and lecturing at different universities in US, and I try to find out that how many graduate level students are there coming from Pakistani universities. It's, I would say out of 10, perhaps two, who have graduated, and unfortunately very, very few who have done undergraduate studies in Karachi. Most of the Pakistani students who are there, they have graduated from American universities, and I'm glad that they identify themselves as Pakistanis. So when we're talking about the criteria that, okay, Aga Khan University, an excellent institution where I taught 20 years, for 20 years, 95% of their students go to the US. Excellent education system. So they are producing doctors for the West. Of course, Aman Tech is doing a very good job providing foreign exchange to the country. But what I'm concerned about, that if you are not having enough quality education being given at the undergraduate level in Pakistan, so that they are tomorrow's leaders, whether they are in the business, they are in administration, or they are in politics, or in teaching, which gets the lowest standard of criteria here in Pakistan. Where are we going to go? I recall most of us are sitting here. I think we have gone through, especially those who are above 50 or at least above 60, we have gone through the public sector education system in school as well as universities. They used to be excellent. I went to University of Karachi in the 70s, an excellent institution, which it is no more. And I think if you look same way as Punjab University or any other institution which had a name, internationally recognized name, 30 years ago, it's no more there. What has happened? Mrs. Shahnaz Wazir Ali, she has seen the school education system in Pakistan with Nasra School, Education Minister of Pakistan, and nowadays she is heading Zabist as president. What do you think about what has happened? Do you think that we have gone wrong somewhere?
I think, Mehtab, you've raised a very fundamental question, which we should all think about very seriously. Are universities only supposed to produce students or graduates who are seeking jobs? I don't think that that's the only function of a university. That's the first point. Universities are supposed to be places of learning, yes. Contemporary knowledge, skills, enlarge your capacities, capabilities, develop your talents, enlarge your mind, read a lot, know about the world, but also create knowledge. And our universities, I think, in terms of research, don't really create knowledge as much as many, many other universities around the world. So I think that's one of the most important detractors, in a sense, in Pakistan at the higher education level. That we enroll a lot of students, they do their bachelor's in any subject, and then they go on to do their master's. And very quickly, basically their big push and their parents' big insistence is, you know, study something that's going to immediately get you a job. Now, we understand that that's very important, but I think there has to be a balance in the higher education sector. And that balance has to be in the creation of a person who can adapt and adopt to the changing world rapidly, who can learn in different ways, who can deal with IT, new ways of technology, and who can also engage in, when he gets to postgraduate level, in research, in inquiry. And we are doing very little of that. I'll add to that maybe a very controversial statement, and many people here may not agree with that. I don't think everybody has a right to go into postgraduate. And I don't think everybody has a right to enter a PhD program, because a PhD program is extremely rigorous. So PhD programs are meant for those who demonstrate their interests, their capacity, their knowledge base, and so forth. Now, what is happening at the undergraduate level is what you asked. Why is the quality of undergraduate university education so poor? It is, of course, a factor of what is the institutional quality. And we talked about that a little bit earlier today, that if you have an institution that has a clearly defined mission, and I would give the example of Habib University with Wasif sitting here next to me, very clearly defined mission, what does your university focus on? Because a university, I know at some in some manner, can also offer a lot of departments, and so there's something for everybody. But I think increasingly universities have to define themselves. And they have to really say what it is that they're very, very good at offering to the students. So if you have a clearly defined mission and you have a high quality faculty and you invest in facilities and faculty and you broaden the learning experience, you're likely to get much better graduates and much better outcomes. All of this requires several types of commitments, and I think that again, I would say that it's not always that the private sector universities are all doing better. Some public sector universities have islands of excellence, and we know that. There's many centers of excellence in different universities in Karachi. But there is a churning out of degrees, and this session is also about wholesaling of degrees. So I think it's a very pertinent question that is there some sort of yardstick to the degree that students are getting from universities? And I think there isn't. Different universities, when they give you a bachelor's in social sciences or in management sciences, etc., are not always necessarily giving you the same product.
Great. Thank you very much. I think it's now we turn to two institutions, quite apart from each other. IOBM, which established itself as an alternate institution besides, when they were established in 1990, I believe, 94, that was one of the first, besides ZABIS, they were the two good institutions established, and they have done about 20 years of, I think by now they're 20 years, both of them. IOBM came up with a different model. They came up with the idea that a small group of people, they can establish an institution, low cost, with donations, no help from the government, and some dedicated people. Talib, what sort of model is this? Do you think that it could be adapted by other foundations, what the Foundation for Higher Education has done in this sector? And do you think that is there any way to have some sort of checklist of what is a quality education in any area? We are talking about most of the three institutions which are represented here, they're all business schools primarily. Of course, they're expanding to different areas. So what do you think about the model which IOBM has worked on? And I would say, would you say it's a successful model which others could adopt?
I think if we look at the history of tertiary level education, I think prior to 1980, there were no private sector universities in Pakistan. I think Aga Khan was one of the first ones, followed by LUMS, and then a few others were established in 80s, ZABIST and Hamdard. But then post-90s, if you look at mid-90s, when we were established in 1995, there were, I think in terms of seniority in Pakistan, I think we will be ranked as number six senior most private sector university. And I'm talking about just 20 years. That 20 years ago, we were the sixth private sector institute, sixth or seventh, that was established. So it's a totally new phenomenon, private sector universities operating in Pakistan. And as we all know that universities evolve over a period of time. takes a long time. If you look at Oxford and Cambridges and Harvard of this world, then you know, we are talking about centuries. So the model that you are talking about, it was a very different model. In 1994, with the seed money of 5 million rupees, a university was established. And from 1996 till now, not a single donation was taken, not a single penny loan was taken, and with zero liability. So how does that model work? It works very effectively, but then it's how the market recognizes you. And because at the end of the day, as Dr. Ishrat said, it's those 10% or 40% or that number which will eventually play, because employers are not in our hands. They have to select from the best institutions, and at the end of the day, it's those employers who will decide that whom to hire. And now, starting from number of universities in Pakistan, they were 40 in number or 45 in number. We are looking at around 160, over 160 universities in Pakistan. Just to answer your question, is that model adaptable? Is that successful? Of course it is. I think it worked with us, and I think some other institutions have also followed that model, where we have always believed that in the education sector and the health sector, it would be a successful model if the money, the surplus revenue that you generate goes back into the infrastructure, into the quality, into the R&D. So if that happens and the money is going back into the system, then yes, it will work. It has worked with us that from nowhere, 92 students in 1995 with a rented premises at PF base. Now we have our own campus over the last 20 years. So, and I'm sure other universities have done the same. I cannot think of a similar model, but I'm sure that universities like Dr. Saab, UMT might have the same model in Lahore, and other universities must be following this model. Now, in terms of quality, as I've said, that at the end of the day, no matter how much we say or how much we project our university and say we are the best, at the end of the day, it will be your graduates who will be going out in the market and will be, so the quality will be gauged in terms of the knowledge that they have gained in those 4 years or 2 years, depending on the level of education. And now, the education is not just a local education. I think we talk about global curriculum. We talk about getting accredited from organizations like AACSB, which is some universities are following that and trying to get themselves accredited through AACSB. Their universities are going for international quality accreditation like APQN and others. So if we don't keep that quality as universities, then we will not be able to compete with other graduates from other universities. So that is very important.
Yeah, thank you very much. Yeah, now we turn to Wasif, the baby of the town. Habib University, I'm saying that the reason that one of the finest campuses in town, of course, IBA is competing very closely with you, an excellent campus now. It was nothing about 8 years ago. So the model you have adopted is liberal arts, I believe, which was not non-existent in Pakistan, you know. I think it's a very good idea. Everybody is wants to become, get a degree in engineering or degree in medicine or a degree in business. They don't become thinkers, unfortunately, in today's age. So it's only the person with liberal arts education who has very, you know, education system which is very, which takes the young person around in different disciplines. That's what you're aiming at, what I understand. The campus is excellent, the curricula is excellent. And I think one good thing you have done, which Aga Khan University also had done about 30 years ago, young and excellent faculty. Do you think that model is going to work in Pakistan?
Well, thank you, Mehtab. I agree with everything that you said. And thank you, Dr. Saab, and thank you, Shahnaz. You all have made impossible for me to disagree with any of you by praising Habib University. A quick word on, so there are two, before I respond to your comment directly. So two stats were mentioned, one by you and one by Dr. Saab, which essentially discredit this title. So Pakistan, correctly, ranks among the lowest countries in the world in tertiary enrollment. We are in the top bottom 10 or 15 countries, and every other country around us is in sub-Saharan Africa, with the exception of Djibouti, which is just by the luck of a tropic, is not sub-Saharan, but still in Africa. So Pakistan is 5.2% by UNESCO's estimate, 10% by HEC's estimate, still remains within the same bracket. So anything that is available only to barely 5% of the eligible clients cannot be called wholesale, right? So I don't think that's a problem. The quality of the higher learning perhaps is the point here, which again is not really the problem. The problem is not the availability or presence of third or fourth tier institutions. The real problem is the paucity or absence of the top tier ones. And Talib Saab, you were not alone. Pakistan is not alone. And 30 years ago, we allowed private institutions. The whole rest of the world just joined in about 50, 60 years ago, with the exception of one country that had it for 450 years, and that's the US. So in the US, private higher education is 100 years older than the country itself. So the first institution in the US was Harvard, which was, I think, founded somewhere in 1640, good 150 years before the country was founded. So for us, it was logical to look at and understand the institution itself. Now, private, high-level, top-tier private university is a very weird, unique institution that does not exist in any form anywhere in the world. It's a private enterprise that is designed to lose money. So all top-tier private universities, by definition, have to be in deficit. Now, this is a prerequisite for their accreditation, regional accreditation. For instance, NEASC, which is New England Association of Schools and Colleges, which is one of the most prestigious accreditation body, which accredits all the Ivy League universities and MIT and so on. So I asked their managing director that why is that the first prerequisite? She says that simple reason. A high-quality private institution needs to demonstrate that it is supported by the society. So it is an institution that is owned and supported by the society. It has to demonstrate that. Right? Now, we live in a, you know, in a bit of a flux. It's just 30 years old. I think our cynicism regarding private enterprise is there anyway. It is especially there. You see that in the media and so on. We do, I think, instinctively as a country believe that this was supposed to be the job of the government. That's fine, you know, that model exists in the world and very adequately so. But I think all of us need to realize that government will not be able to do it. Right? Again, we have just 5% of the possible people going into tertiary education. And Pakistani state is not going to do it. So a lot of very smart people who have found it as a supply-demand opportunity have jumped in that, but still they are a fraction of what is required. So I think the society and institutionally, if we accept and adopt a sensible ecosystem of supporting private universities, that is one way of addressing some of this cynicism, that if they are good or bad. Now, why liberal arts? This points to a point that Shahnaz raised, which is, to me, is a key point. We, like many post-colonial societies, adopted a utilitarian educational model. Somewhere in the early 60s, the legend has it that Ayub Saab, at the height of his supposed popularity, ventured into East Pakistan. And to his shock and horror, he encountered student demonstrations. So his good advisors, probably Americans, advised him that, you know, this university is a problem. This kind of university. They're giving us hell over Vietnam. Look what they are doing in France. Why don't you just turn them into what they call trade schools? Just job-driven vocational centers. And it worked like a charm. So all Pakistani universities overnight were converted into medical engineering and the rest. Now, fast forward 50 years now, there's a very good British Council study. Now, so people like me, middle class, have been horrified by something that's been going on for 35 years, that why are we finding all the terrorist leaders coming out of universities? Well, it's nothing new. It's been happening. But the study is very telling, that they found, they have tracked about 1,500 or so from around the world, pretty noted names in the echelons of Al-Qaeda and ISIS, who are met doctors or engineers or bankers or whoever they were. And they found none of them who had a humanities background. Right? Now this is... it's a good statistical sample. Now, I had the good fortune of talking to His Highness the Aga Khan, the creator of the first private university in Pakistan, and it was a great honor. And we had a conversation in which I very respectfully posited that one can be a fully functional human being and not be a doctor, right? And not be an engineer, and even not do an MBA. But you can't be one without a sense of history, without a sense of being, without a sense of knowing where you are and who you are. And if universities continue to sidestep that question, somebody else is giving the answer. And that answer is usually very nefarious. So this is, for us, is a no-brainer, that how do you create an engaged experience for young men and women in a university? You do it by addressing these fundamental aspects which are necessary, perhaps natural to human condition. Now, at Habib University, there are 7 forms of thought and action that you have to fulfill 11 courses, no matter what you're doing. You want to become an engineer, good for you. You want to become a social development expert, good for you. But you have to do 2 courses in historical and social thought, 2 in philosophical thought, courses in creative practice, courses in quantitative reasoning, courses in scientific method and inquiry, and I think I'm forgetting one. So there are many Habib University people, but there are 7. So there are 7 forms of thought that you have to do 11 courses. Now, it's not something that we, going back to the original model. We talked to Stanford, we talked to Harvard, they have figured out a breadth, essentially defined, not in similar terms, but somewhat similar model, and we had to give it our own context. Now, our expectation is that universities, every university in this country, should aim towards creating an engaged experience that will arrest a good percentage of those 95% who leave, that will create the quiet confidence in the students that they understand this place and they can deal with it. They can actually do something interesting and problem-solving worthy in this part of the world. And I think that's what universities, at this point in history at least, ought to be doing. Very good.
You see, Mehtab, that's the difference.
Yeah. Thanks,
when you have somebody who's leading a liberal arts university, that is what is going to bring the change.
Right,
and I really believe in it. And I think that this is the trend that you're seeing everywhere in the world.
So I'm coming,
that good universities give you a wide base of the understanding of the human experience, and which is what we have not done. We've narrowed ourselves into mechanical engineering and medicine and you know, electrical engineering, and that's a big loss for our students.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, very interestingly, two anecdotes. When I went to study at the University of Chicago, I asked my advisor, what courses shall I take, because I am a social sciences major. He said, go and take one course in mathematics and one course in physics. I said, I've never studied there. So if you want to learn something new, okay? But one thing very interesting was what you were talking about, the doctors being human beings. When I was being interviewed at Aga Khan University in 1983, I just did my PhD a couple of years ago, and I had a good job in the US. I came for interview and asked the dean, Dean Smythe, that why do you want to hire a social scientist at a medical school? He said, I want my graduates to be human beings as well, besides doctors. So that was something which Aga Khan model, I think, has very successfully adopted. I'm sure that others are going to do the same. Now, I think the burning question, which is from all of you, I know and all of us know that all the institutions which are being represented here, they are meant for the children of elite. They're meant for the children of people who are upper middle class. Glad to know that you said that you are middle class. I'm sure that you are not, and most of us are not. Let's admit it.
We are very much middle class.
But a university which costs 2 lakhs of rupees, and of course 5 times more at Habib, who is going to afford that? Provided. You have a system under which the admission is blind, and anybody who is admitted should be given a chance to join. That's what is needed. So I have these questions from all four of you.
Let me answer that.
Yeah, sure. Dr. Saab is
I think this is a myth that all the elite schools only cater to the middle or upper middle class. If you take Aga Khan, you take LUMS, you take Habib, you take IBA, there's a needs-blind admission policy.
Completely.
A student who has gone to the interior of Sindh or to Gilgit-Baltistan, if he or she is able to secure admission, all their financial needs, including lodging and boarding, are taken care of. And we have students at IBA who are children of a clerk, a laborer, a sipahi, an NGO, NCO of the army. 500 students out of 2,500 are all being supported financially, food partially or fully, depending on their needs. This is what is happening actually. We live in a completely, you know, mythical and assume that this is what is happening. The model for private education is that those who can afford to pay should pay the full price, because the private returns to the family, to the individual, are much higher than the social returns. Therefore, 70% or 80% who are able to afford that price should pay for that, and 30% or 25%, or my guess is even 50%, who cannot afford to be subsidized, cross-subsidized by these rich people. That's why the quality of education can be maintained. We can hire teachers of high quality. I cannot afford to pay them peanuts and expect that my graduates will come out with flying colors, welcomed by the employers. This is happening in most universities. You go to IBA Sakhar, 70% of the students are on financial support. They are all from the rural areas of Sindh. We have a SIN talent hunt program, a KPK talent hunt program, a Balochistan talent hunt program, where we bring the students from matriculation and intermediate classes, give them training at our expense for 2 months in English, in math, in computer science, how to dress up, how to speak, and if they are selected through our competitive entrance exam, for 4 years, we take care of all their expenditures. This is how you have social mobility. You provide opportunity to those who deserve it. Therefore, this myth about elitist schools, I think, is not grounded in reality.
I think I totally agree with Dr. Ishrat. I think, and we take, as a private sector institutions being represented here, we take that bad or negative rap all the time that we don't cater to that segment of the society who deserves to be, who deserves to get that higher education. We don't publicize all that. We should not. I think whatever we should do, we should do it with clear conscience. And yes, our number would be around 30-35% who are on financial assistance. And yes, no questions are asked. And these, I think it goes for most of private sector universities, that they're admitted. And if they are unable to pay, then they are provided financial assistance. Outreach programs are very much common now. I think we took a lot of good practices from other institutions and are following that, where we recruited almost 20 students from Interior Sindh, from Tharparkar, Mithi, and other areas. Full boarding and lodging are being provided, and they are going to get 4 years of education with us. I'll just end with one example, and Dr. Ishrat will have a lot of those examples, but I'll just, there's a girl from Citizen Foundation, went through our system, did her bachelor's, and while she was doing her master's in human resource, was picked by Harvard Business Summer School to do her summer school at Harvard, fully paid by Harvard, by United States Embassy. She came back and completed her master's and was able to find a job of starting 75,000 rupees in a pharmaceutical company, and her father earns 10,000 rupees per month as a driver. So I think these are examples which are common in all the universities sitting here and other universities. And I think Dr. Ishrat is right about the myth that that is not true. I think we cater to all segments of the society, and we need to give back to the society, because a lot of those people really deserve to be educated in good institutions so that they can also make their career.
Yeah, thank you very much. So we heard from both private sector and public sector institutions that no problem. So they have no financial issues. Yes, Zabis, do you have any financial issues related to that? Can you afford that, to pay 50%?
We have about
scholarships.
67% of our students get some form of scholarship or the other. So it's a fairly high percentage, either 100% or 75% or 50%. And we also have a needs-blind admission policy. So anyone who clears the admission test and has made it on his merit, his or her merit, will be admitted to Zavist. And we also have campuses in Larkana and Hyderabad. So we are catering, you know, to different parts of Sindh. But I think the question is also that, which is a social question, that the richest families of Pakistan send their children abroad. You know, they are not the ones who are sending their children to Pakistani universities. And they have opted to send their children to good universities abroad. In the last few years, I think you're beginning to see just the emergence of a different type of thought, that there are now good universities in Pakistan, and that some families are now opting to send their children to the top-ranking universities here, and then later on for postgraduate studies abroad. I think the government needs to do more about providing financial assistance, to private sector universities. There should be some sort of a merit scheme that government also supports.
course, Habib is, of course, far, far ahead. I hear that 80% of his students are financially being supported. What will happen when they are, you have full capacity, when you have 1,000 students, you will still keep on doing so?
Yeah, it's 92%.
92, great.
92%, that's fantastic.
Just, I think it just goes back to a point that I briefly mentioned in my first comment, which is the cynicism. I think there is this confusion that we all have that the higher education or all education should be free. And if we have now the reality of private universities and who have to sort of figure out some economics for themselves, that cynicism raises its head. We need to understand the institution. Now Stanford, which is one of the richest universities in the world, has a 65% recovery and 35% discount, which they spread to whichever student needs. Now we have benchmarked ourselves to 48% recovery, 52% discount, which is spread to 92%. And we will continue roughly around that particular calculation. Now the question that, the point that Shehnaz made briefly, I think it is equally important. I think there has to be some sort of a vision for top universities like the IBA or Zabist or IOBM or Habib to engage with elite as well. It really doesn't help if they are being educated outside of Pakistan. This is so eventually, you know, the statistical probability for them to be decision makers about Pakistan is quite high. And if they have such a disengaged, alienated experience of their education. So I think for a university, I don't feel, you know, I may say something controversial, you know, I should be able to admit Mansha's grandson. Hopefully he'll be a little less damaging than his granddad.
Yeah, great. Yeah, but what I hear that, what I hear that Harvard is seriously thinking about a tuition-free campus. No more, I think, except the trustees are not very much in favor of that, but I think but Stanford and Harvard are taking leads in no more tuition fee from the students.
All right, well, now, anyways, 65%.
I think...
certainly charge foreign students a very high
I think the headline for tomorrow should be that there's no financial crisis in the universities and the public sector universities, which are all the time are asking for more and more money, that's not needed. They should follow the examples of these four great institutions, you know, which are represented here. Now, the next is going to the floor. Please, only questions, no comments, just identify yourself, please, sir. Just not more than 30 seconds, because we'll have more questions and answers then.
Hello. My name is Irfan Ahmed, and I started my career in the teaching about 45 years ago at a university, which I left after 6 months. Question to everybody. Now, we agree that quality of education in Pakistan has gone down. In the recent years, that means last 20, 25 years. The public sector universities are financed mostly by the taxpayers, and the private universities mostly are doing business. Both of these should be held accountable. And most of you here were the decision makers. How would you like yourself to be held accountable for the quality of education going down in Pakistan?
I don't agree with you that the quality of education has gone down. There's a tiering of quality. There are more institutions which are high quality institutions as compared to 10 or 20 years ago. There is a middle level, and then there is a complete proliferation of fly-by-night institutions which have come up. In India, there are 3,000 business schools in rented premises without any teacher, without any facility. But the market penalizes them because their graduates, after paying huge fees, cannot get a job. So that is the accountability mechanism. Whether your students, when they graduate, they can get a job or not, that is the criterion. And I'm so happy that 10 years ago, the Mehran universities and UETs and the NED didn't have that kind of market value. Today, when I talk to the employer, they say, if we want to get the engineers, we get from the public sector universities of engineering. On the other hand, the medical universities have gone down, and I blame the PMDC for that, because the PMDC has done the greatest disservice to this country by allowing third-rate, fake kind of medical colleges which have come up throughout the country. They are not even producing quacks. The quacks in the rural areas are much better than the doctors which are being produced by these private medical colleges by 6 to 7 lakhs of rupees every year. So that is a difference I wanted to. So it's not one shoe fits all. It's a more nuanced picture as far as the quality of education is concerned.
Yeah, please, a lady with glasses.
I have a question. Does this not all originate from the poor quality primary and secondary school education and no advisors available to guide the students as to where their interests lie and where their future can be improved, which subjects to choose when they go to university? So when a child is not exposed to a liberal curriculum, when a child is not exposed to history or geography as we were as students, they don't know which way to go except medicine and engineering and architecture or IBA. They're not guided any other way. If we have guidance counselors for schools, then only can the universities begin to improve with the quality of students going in.
Yes, I agree with you. I think secondary schools all need guidance counselors, and primary school quality needs to be improved. I don't think there's any debate on that. But most of the students who get into the better universities in Pakistan, by and large come from the urban private sector schools.
She has raised her hand right from the beginning. Lady with pink shirt.
The red is standing.
Red shirt. Cutting in.
Hello. My question to the panel regarding the wholesaling of degrees is that I study at Habib, and when I tell people that we have a very holistic education, is one of the replies I get ki ye sab padhne ka fayda kya hai, rhetoric padhne ka kya fayda, Urdu padhne ka kya fayda. So when you talk about the wholesaling of degrees and how we've become so narrow-minded, is it just the universities, or do you think it's also the society itself, and how do you change that?
It's a little unfair, she's my student.
Okay.
But I would love to hear it from the other experts.
No, I think what we did, for example, said to the BBA students that you have to have at least 8 courses in philosophy, psychology, history, political science, compulsory. You won't graduate. Secondly, 8 weeks you have to go and work in the communities, whether you work with the TCF, whether you work with Teach for Pakistan, or you work for SIUT, or you go to the villages. So you should look at the poverty, and you are so privileged that you are getting this higher education, and your other cohorts are not going. And that creates a completely different mindset, because they observe things, they are sensitive, they are young. The education plus the real life observation make them a much better human being and a professional. And this combination of human being and professional is that what Pakistan really needs.
You also just give the little blue shirt, Gigi.
Assalamu alaikum sir, my name is Imtiaz Ali. आप लोगों से आप लोगों की इस बात से एग्री करते हैं कि स्कॉलरशिप्स अवेलेबल हैं आप लोगों के इंस्टीट्यूशंस में, लेकिन जो बच्चा मैट्रिक करता है पीले स्कूल से और जो बच्चा अंडर प्रिविलेज एरिया से मैट्रिक करता है और इंटर बोर्ड से इंटर करता है वो SAT लेवल का या उससे कंपेरेटिव टेस्ट पास कर सकता है आपके इंस्टीट्यूशन में आने के लिए, आप खुद ही बताएं। दूसरी
बस एक काफी है। जी क्विकली क्विकली।
थैंक यू। अस्सलाम वालेकुम, मेरा नाम अरीब मिनहाज है। सर मेरे सिंपल से एक सवाल है कि क्या आप लोग एडमिशन पॉलिसी बनाते हुए आप प्लानिंग कमीशन को कंसिडर करते हैं कि हमारे पास कितनी इंडस्ट्रीज़ हैं, हम कितने ग्रेजुएट्स निकाल सकते हैं। एक छोटा सी बात करूँगा, 25 यूनिवर्सिटीज़ हैं जो इलेक्ट्रिकल इंजीनियरिंग की डिग्री दे रही हैं, सही है, और कुल मिला के जो ग्रेजुएट्स की तादाद है वो है 500 से भी ज़्यादा ईयरली, सही है? और मुझे आप बताएं कि क्या हमारे पास इतनी इंडस्ट्रीज़ हैं जितने आप लोग ग्रेजुएट्स निकाल रहे हैं। हबीब ने दोबारा से, अभी CBM ने रिसेंटली इलेक्ट्रिकल इंजीनियरिंग में हाथ डाला, ऑलरेडी इतनी सारी यूनिवर्सिटीज़ थी, तो क्या आप लोग एडमिशन पॉलिसी बनाते हुए ये सारी चीज़ें तय करते हुए आप ये देखते हैं कि कितनी इंडस्ट्रीज़ हम निकाल रहे हैं?
काफ़ी। जस्ट फाइनल क्वेश्चन प्लीज लेडी हियर। जी जी प्लीज आप।
जी अस्सलामुअलैकुम, मेरा सवाल पैनल से ये है कि मेरे बच्चे अगर हम लोग बाहर नहीं भेज रहे हैं और हम ऑप्ट करते हैं पाकिस्तान में पढ़ाने के लिए, तो हमें एक अनफॉर्चुनेटली हमारे पर गवर्नमेंट की तरफ से 5% टैक्स लगा हुआ है जो हमें बच्चों की फ़ीस पे देना पड़ता है, तो उसके बारे में आप लोगों का क्या पैनल इसके बारे में क्या हमें बता सकता है? लाइक मेरे बच्चे इंडस वैली में या IBM में पढ़ रहे हैं तो उसकी तो हेफ्टी अमाउंट एक जा रहा है, ऊपर से हम 5% भी दे रहे हैं गवर्नमेंट को, तो हमें गवर्नमेंट तो रिलीफ नहीं दे रही है। थैंक यू।
चलिए, आई थिंक ऑल दीस क्वेश्चंस रिलेट टू द फाइनेंशियल इश्यूज।
आई थिंक वन क्वेश्चन
देयर। ए चलिए आप, इफ दे आर रिलेटेड। ओके,
माय नेम इज डॉक्टर अखलाक। हेलो, माय क्वेश्चन इज टू शहनाज वजीर अली, बिकॉज़ शी हैज बीन विद HEC एंड शी हैज आल्सो looked after the school and college system. Why is it that the government of Pakistan has diverted the attention of education to only private sector? Why they have gone down? Why they have shifted the responsibility of the nation, the people, the students to the private sector? Although I know there are very good private institutions in Pakistan, but are they enough? Can the poor people afford to send their children to these institutions which are of very high quality? Yes, no doubt.
Okay.
So who is responsible for this?
I think that's it. We don't have any more questions to be taken. Yes. Because we have to wrap up, only 5 minutes. I'd like each of you to kindly say a few
very
words.
Quickly, I'll take your question first.
Yeah.
Clearly, there is a failure of the state. There's no doubt about that as far as schooling is concerned. And the failure of the state has automatically led to the determination by the market. And so the private sector has mushroomed. The private sector has not grown because the government has encouraged it to grow, but in an indirect way, the failure of the state to deliver good quality education has turned people towards private sector schools. And fundamentally, it is the responsibility of the government of Pakistan and the provincial governments to provide good quality education to all the citizens of Pakistan, and that's what Article 25A in the 18th Amendment talks about. I think the other questions, I won't take long because the other panelists will speak to it, just to speak to the question of the test. As you know, the entry admissions criteria determined by the Higher Education Commission is a score of 55% intermediate. And 60% for engineering and computer sciences if you need to enter that. So anybody who's done well, it doesn't matter. Agar wo Sakhar se hain, Hyderabad se hain, Tando Mama Jam se hain, jahan se bhi hain, agar unhone 60% apne inter board mein score hasil kar liya hai, to wo admission ke liye eligible hain. Aur agar 55% dusri subjects mein kar liya hai, to wo eligible hai admissions ke liye.
Dekhiye.
जी
हाँ, सेम आपका सवाल सही है कि अगर वो सेट और उससे मिलते जुलते टेस्ट हैं तो उनको डिसएडवांटेज है, ये तो बिल्कुल ऑब्वियस सी बात है। तो इसका ये मतलब है कि हमारी जैसी यूनिवर्सिटीज़ को सेट और उससे मिलते जुलते टेस्ट पर डिपेंडेंसी कम करना है, और ये कोई आसान काम नहीं है क्योंकि वो बहुत एडवांस टेस्ट हैं और उस पर फैकल्टी का भी एतबार है कि अगर वो उसमें से आएंगे, ज़ाहिर है उनको क्लासरूम में باقی لوگوں کے ساتھ بھی کمپیٹ کرنا ہے. جو ہمارا طریقہ کار ہے وہ یہ ہے کہ ہم ایسے وہ کسی بھی زبان میں لکھ سکتے ہیں, وہ سندھی میں بھی لکھ سکتے ہیں, پنجابی میں بھی لکھ سکتے ہیں, اردو میں بھی لکھ سکتے ہیں. اور ایسے جو ہے کاؤنٹس فار مور دین اینی تھنگ ایٹ فار ایڈمیشن ایٹ حبیب. دوسرا جو جیسے شہناز نے کہا کہ گریڈ ایگزمپشن بھی ہے, اگر وہ ہونہار ہیں اور انہوں نے ایف ایس سی میں ایک مقررہ حد سے زیادہ گریڈ ہے ان کا, تو وہ بھی ٹیسٹ سے ایگزمپٹڈ ہے. لیکن یہ صرف آغاز ہے. ہمارا یہ خیال ہے کہ ہمیں اس پہ بہت کام کرنا ہے. یہ پچھلے 40-50 سال سے یہ نظام بنا ہے جو کہ ان ٹیسٹ پر ڈپینڈنٹ ہے, جو ٹیسٹ انفیوریبلی ایک خاص طرح کی سیکنڈری ایجوکیشن کو کے ساتھ ان کے ساتھ ان کا کمپیریٹو بہتر ہے. تو یور کوشچن از ویلڈ بٹ آئی تھنک وی کین وی ہیو اسٹارٹڈ ٹو ایڈریس اٹ.
میں صرف جسٹ وانٹ ٹو ٹچ اپون یور ٹیکس ایشو. آپ کو جو وہ فیل ہو رہا ہے دا اوور 2 lakhs اف یو پے فیز اینڈ یو گیٹ وتھ ہولڈنگ ٹیکس, یو نو وی آلسو آر ٹیکسڈ ہیویلی نو اسپیشلی ڈاکٹر اشرت وتھ ایس ایس ٹیز. آئی ڈونٹ نو, آئی تھنک پبلک سیکٹر یونیورسٹیز آر ایگزمپٹڈ فرام ایس ایس ٹیز سنس سیلس ٹیکس کی میں بات کر رہا ہوں. یو نو جی ایس ٹی ایس ایس ٹی, یو نو وی بائی ون اکوپمنٹ اینڈ وی آر ٹیکس سو ہیویلی آن دوز اکوپمنٹ بیکاز وی آر I call it as double taxation because we are paying it to the federal government, we are paying it to the Sindh government. So yeah, that, and we don't get any relief as a university on these taxes. And basically it's the failure of the government that they're unable to go for a collection of direct taxes, so they tend to go through these indirect taxes, and that's where they get the revenue from. So I totally agree with you that it's unfair, it should not be there. You know, one has to follow.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. On the fees.
Yeah. Any concluding remarks? Okay, I think that's it.
Can I ask one question, please?
No, please, I think it's all finished. You can talk to any of the panelists later. I would like to thank all the panelists. And great audience, very interactive.
Thank you
very much.
Actually, did he even address the whole question of wholesaling of degrees? Uska to debate badi mazedar honi. Real wholesaling.